rejoice in the gift of the new day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We've come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, to pray for the needs of the world, and to seek the forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit we may give ourselves to the service of God.
This week, hopefully In Touch will come out, and as with In Touch, also with the Good News newspapers that are in the Northex. Both of them are intended to be part of the way in which we can sort of potentially gently reach out beyond ourselves. So the In Touch will be in a paper format, but also on the website with a link onto the Facebook page. And there are the newspapers there. And the hope is that you can take them, maybe invite somebody around for a coffee and just put them on the there and maybe hope that they will pick them up and read it. Maybe put them in the door of somebody that you know might want it. And use that that way. Next Saturday is the first Saturday of the month, so there will be a grounds working party again as per normal. And we are now back at having both Thursday services and Sunday services. So it was lovely on Thursday that between the Book of Common Prayer and the morning and the family in the service in the evening, we were pushing up towards the number we had last Sunday. Here in church, and so that's just lovely to hold the whole of our worshipping community together with our online community who are joining us online, and remembering that it's not just us here, but we're surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, those that come on Thursday, those that are part of our online group, and that we're all here working together for the glory of God. I think that's all the notices I need to... Oh, except the APCM is coming up. It actually is going to come up at the end of May, and so do start to watch for all the information about the final PCC before the APCM, and then nominations for roles, and start to pray whether God is actually laying on your heart to be part of the PCC and to serve perhaps more in the life of the church.
So may we have our first reading, please, Margaret?
The first reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 49, verses 1 to 13. The servant of the Lord. Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my birth, he has made mention of my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But I said, "I have labored to no purpose. I have spent my strength in vain for nothing. Yet what is due to me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself, for I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength," he says. "It is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring my salvation to the ends of the earth." This is what the Lord says, the Redeemer of the Holy One is of Israel. To him was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers. Kings will see you and rise up, princes will see and bow down, because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel who has chosen you. Restoration of Israel. This is what the Lord says. In the time of my favor, I will answer you. And in the day of salvation, I will help you. I will keep you and will make you to be a covenant for the people, to restore the land and to reassign its desolate inheritances, to say to the captives, "Come out," and to those in darkness, "Be free." They will feed beside the roads and find pasture on the barren hill. They will neither hunger nor thirst, nor will the desert heat or the sun beat upon them. He who has compassion on them will guide them and lead them beside springs of water. I will turn all my mountains into roads, and my highways will be raised up. See, they will come from afar, some from the north, some from the west, some from the region of Aswan. Shout for joy, O heavens, shout, rejoice, O earth, burst into song, O mountains. For the Lord comforts his people and will have compassion on his afflicted ones. This is the word of the Lord.
And now we have a responsory, a song of the covenant. The Lord says to his people, I have given you as a light to the nations, and I have called you in righteousness. Thus says God, who created the heavens, who fashioned the earth and all that dwell in it, who gives breath to the people upon it and spirit to those who walk in it. I have given you as a light to the nations, and I have called you in righteousness. I am the Lord, and I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I have given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind. I have given you as a light to the nations, and I have called you in righteousness, to bring out captives from the dungeon, from the prison those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other. I have given you as a light to the nations, and I have called you in righteousness. Jesus said, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. I have given you as a light to the nations, and I have called you in righteousness. Almighty Father, whose Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, may we, your people, shine with the radiance of his glory, now and forever. Amen. And now we have our gospel reading.
The second reading is taken from John's Gospel, chapter 10, verses 11 to 18. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord. Amen. It's a rather old joke, but there's the story about a man in bed, and the voice comes up from downstairs. It's time to go to church. Get up. I don't want to go today. But you have to go. Leave me alone, Mum. I don't want to go. But you're doing something. I'm always doing something. I'm bored of that and it's just too hard. I don't want to go. But you just have to be there. You can't let them down. But they don't like me anyway. You have to go. Why do I have to go? Because you're the vicar. Sometimes ministry and life is hard, and it may not just be the vicar, those who set up toddler groups and have to be there first to set it up or take it down afterwards, and everybody's just made a mess of it and trampled mud through, or it may be those that come up twice a week and garden or take a responsibility for a particular area or come and give up a Saturday morning. It may be those who make phone calls and just think, I'll do the pastoral phone call. I'll phone them tomorrow. I won't do that today. Or take the time to take out communion to people's homes. Or whatever ministry we're involved in. It may be those who do ministry as part of the rest of their life, living out their faith in the workplace, and just think, oh, it doesn't matter if I don't live up to the standards I've set for myself today and I just take home a pad of paper. That doesn't matter today. Or the way I am a witness, doesn't matter if I'm snappy with people today. And ministry can both be a delight, and it can also just feel like a hard slog. And that seems to be some of what's coming across in the Isaiah passage today. If you read it, and not just, I've been encouraging you to read the whole of Isaiah 40 to 55, and it's good to sit back and read that in one sitting, and you'll just see so many things that are picked up in the New Testament, time and time again, chapter after chapter. But here in this particular chapter, and if you read the whole chapter, you'll see there's this sort of tension. You've got two characters there. One is God, and the other is, I've called them a psalmist, the poet who's writing it. And the poet seems to be oscillating between two extremes. One is in the opening line where, from my mother's womb I've been known to God, and they've known me before I've even started to breathe breath, and that God formed me in there to have certain skills and abilities, a tongue that is sharp, that will be picked up when in Revelation about Jesus and his ministry. And it seems really positive that this is somebody who really from their birth has been out there going for it in ministry and just shaped up to take ground for the kingdom. And then a few verses later they just go, oh, but it's so hard and nothing I say seems to have any work or effect. And it's not changed the statistics. And so the equivalent in the modern day for Isaiah there, 100 years after the Assyrians, now in the chapters that are in the context of Babylon, going sort of like 100 years on, we've just not learned anything. And we could say in the modern day, we've had 100 years of statistical church decline in the West. It's just not going anywhere. Oh, it's just awful. What's the point in carrying on? Or perhaps it's we've done a year of COVID and just getting started and getting back towards whatever new normal time means. It's just too much of a heavy lift to go on. And the psalmist oscillates between the two, and you'll find if you carried on reading after quite a high point at the end where we finished in verse, I think it was 13, wasn't it, Margaret? As we carry on, then the psalmist goes depressed again and goes, oh. And that's what it feels like in ministry. Perhaps it's a seasonal thing. Perhaps in the winter it's just harder to do those things than in the summer when the spring's in our step. Perhaps there's other factors that play into it in terms of how much the community has encouraged you in your ministry recently, or how much they've laid on you. Well, do you realise there was crumbs left on the floor after that? And you just think, well, why do I bother? All those sort of things shape up our journey through ministry, and obviously were true in the days of the Babylonian exile, where they were just sort of, what does it mean to still be the people of God? How do we keep that going? And God speaks to the poet and says, I knew you from your mother's womb. I've got a purpose for you. And the poet sort of replies with something along the lines of, well, we just want to get back to the way we were. We just want to get back to the temple, get back to Israel. We just want to be what we were before. At least reading between the lines, that seems to be it. And God says to them, don't you realize that's too small a thing just to go back to where you were? My plan for you is to make you a light to the nations. And perhaps the Church of England and the Church in the West is guilty of going, oh, we just want to go back to the point where churches were full and people were coming. We just want to go back to the point where we had a minister full time in each church and a curate and other things. And the echo of this would be God saying to us, it's not my main purpose to take you back to where you were, to take us back to pre-COVID and the number of people that were coming to church last year. My plan is to take you forward and make you a light to the nations, to make you reach out and transform the world out there and go beyond the bounds of where you were before, to take you beyond where you thought God was and the comfort blanket that you had into a bigger ministry and see the wonders of what God can do. And God's invite to be to step out and beyond. Now this passage obviously was true for the poet who wrote it. And it picks up, and we could go through if we wanted to, various places where it picks up other themes in the Bible and earlier. But then we see it also starting to shape out for later people's ministry. We see it shaping out for Jesus, as this is the first of those servant sort of songs, the theme of the servant starting to come out in this section of Isaiah, the one that is despised by nations, but God lifts up and everybody bows down to. And suddenly you go, this is talking about Jesus and his ministry. That his ministry was to go beyond just establishing Israel in first century Palestine, but to be a light to the nations and to draw all people to him. But it wasn't just talking about Jesus. Because in Acts chapter 13, Paul is describing his ministry and why his ministry goes beyond just being a ministry to the Jews. And he says, in my mother's womb, God designed me for something and a purpose. And then as he builds his argument, it's to be a light to the nations. And he's drawing on this passage as shaping his ministry. So what was true for the poet was most perfectly true in Jesus, but also was true in Paul. Perhaps that's because Paul is joining in the ministry of the body of Christ and doing it. And perhaps that helps us to see this little point in the passage where the person's going, I can't do this. This ministry's too hard. I cannot undo 100 years of church decline by myself. And the voice that comes to the poet is, 100 years in exile, the voice that comes to him is, you're my servant Israel. You are carrying the vocation in yourself of the whole community. And the message then is perfectly true in Jesus, that Jesus initiates and starts the ministry of the church. And then in Paul, as part of the body of Christ, he carries forward the ministry of the church. And God seems to speak to individuals and invite them into ministry, and they carry forward the ministry of the church. And it's not enough for us just to say, oh, the church over there is just failing. Whew. But God says to us, be part of the solution. That what you do is part of the solution. That God takes what you can do and makes it part of the solution. And you carry forward the vocation of the church. And the good news is that though no one of us is strong enough, When the Holy Spirit acts as a catalyst and takes it beyond what each of us can do, then the sum total of the whole is greater than the individual parts. And God invites us into his ministry to be church. And the message that God shared with the poet was that it's your turn now to carry forward the vocation of church, and then just watch to see how much bigger it is that God can achieve in his plans. And God says to you and to me, what is it that you can do to do the ministry of the church so that other people are blessed and drawn in to know Jesus? And that may be for that some of us have a vocation, as some do here, to feed the homeless. And others in the ministry to the TOTS group or the ministry to nursing home, and others making telephone calls daily or weekly to people and pastorally connecting with them and being a shepherd to the sheep. And for others, it's in ministry in church, whether that's at the front or the treasurer or wardens that are more hidden, those that clean, those that take care of the church grounds. And for others, it's how we do being an undertaker for Malcolm, who's not here today, and that's his vocation. And for others, it's how we are with our family and being grandparent to our kids. And if you read the rest of the chapter 49, it's not just about being a light to the nations, but the second half of chapter 49 is passing on to future generations, how we pass on the baton of faith to our children and our children's children. And the burden is heavy on the poets, but God still says that he's going to reach out, and he's going to reach out through his humble servant, not the one who's got multi-million pound production company in their church behind them, but the humble servant who's despised by everybody else will be the one who seems to transform people's lives. And when I was young, my parents used to take us on a very small Christian camp called Methodist Revival Fellowship. Well, Methodist Revival Fellowship was a larger organisation. It's now become Headway in Methodism, and it prays that God will do again in this generation what he did in the Wesleyan generation and in the Hugh Bourne generation for the Primitive Methodists, etc., etc. And that God will repeat that again. But they used to do a small camp, and perhaps there'd be sort of 30 or 40 families that went on this camp together. And one of the guys that went was named Alf. And Alf was never a preacher. And Alf was never at the front, but he used to help to organise it. And he used to be connected to probably everybody that was camping on the field. And I know for my parents, he sent a little gift of money and a letter of support at one point when things were really difficult for them. And when I was in London with the London City Mission as a voluntary evangelist for a few months, Alf died. And it's one of those few times I've just spontaneously burst into tears. And for most people, they wouldn't necessarily have noticed Alf. But actually, Alf ended up having about 3 memorial services. I went to one of them. Because in his small and possibly lowly despised ministry, in his humility, he touched so many lives and blessed them and drew them closer to Jesus that lots of people just wanted to meet. And this wasn't in COVID days when there could only be 30. The church was packed each time, I'm told. Because God takes the ministry that we can offer and transforms it into his glory. He takes the humble servants and raises them up so that kings bow down and people take notice. He takes yours and my ministry and multiplies it together to his glory so that the Holy Spirit works something that's greater than the whole. So today and this week, just ask yourself that question. What can I do that is church for others, that will bless them and draw them closer to Jesus? Let's pray. Father God, it's so easy, like this poet, to feel despair. And yet you shaped us and made us and have a purpose for our lives. Help us to understand how you shaped us to be, that we can live out our part of being church for others, so that your kingdom will grow. Amen.
Let us affirm our faith in the form of the short creed. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his joy. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with the power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And now the collect for the fourth Sunday of Easter. Almighty God, whose Son Jesus Christ is the resurrection and the life, raise us who trust in him from death, from the death of sin, unto the life of righteousness, that we may seek those things which are above, where he liveth and reigneth with thee, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now may we have our prayers and intercession.
Power of the Spirit and in union with Christ, let us pray. Lord God, your Son appeared to his disciples for 40 days after his resurrection, teaching them to love all people as friends and neighbours. We too are his disciples, and today we bring you our prayers on behalf of the Church, the world in which we live, and all those with whom we share it. We pray for your church throughout the world, the great family of which we are all a part. Bless our fellow Christians in the developing world, those for whom hunger is a daily reality, those who feel powerless to change the ways of nature or the ways of nations. In particular today, we remember the people in the eastern DR Congo who have seen further incidents and terrible atrocities committed by rebel groups. We pray for the authorities to bring an end to this cycle of violence, which impacts every sphere of life. For the provision of food, care, shelter, and God's blessing on the church's responses. For peace, so that people may return home and rebuild their lives. And for church leaders, pastors, lay workers, and Mothers Union members as they lead churches and reach out to their communities with compassion, care, and the good news of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all here in our parish of Disley, at St. Mary's and St. John's. We give thanks for the fellowship which we find in these churches and the support we give to each other as we seek to put our faith into practice in our daily lives and adapt to the changes we are all facing as lockdown restrictions are lifted. We pray for Stuart, our vicar, our readers and pastoral workers, and all others who step forward into ministry. We know that your church is its people, and we gain encouragement from each other in the continuation of its work, even though at the present time our opportunities to come together are limited. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the leaders of all nations around the world as they seek to handle the coronavirus pandemic. Although we in this country are hopefully moving into better times following the relaxation of lockdown and the vaccination rollout, there are so many places in the world where people are suffering and dying in very difficult conditions. We all face an uncertain future for our countries. None of us can know what is to come, but we know that the Holy Spirit is always with us, beside us, and we pray that we overcome this global crisis and we build a more just and humane world. Bless Elizabeth, our Queen, and all the members of the royal family as they resume their duties in service to the nation following the official period of mourning, and bring wisdom to all in leadership that they may make sound decisions which will benefit all people. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember all who suffer in mind, body, or spirit. And at this time, particularly remember those who are anxious, worried about leaving their homes, returning to the workplace, or out into the community. Support all who give their strength, their skill, and their stamina to minister to others. May we play our part, however small, to bring your love and comfort to others. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We remember those we have loved but see no more, and in a moment of quiet, we bring to mind those known to us personally. May they and all the departed rest in peace, and those who mourn them know that you are with them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, as we bring you our prayers for the world and for ourselves, during the coming week, help us to spend some time in quiet and reflect on the needs of others and on our own experiences. As we reflect, it may be that you, God, will speak into that silence and help us to understand how we can each play our part in building your new world. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
And we'll have a song.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul, I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won, he is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my no more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings. day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God, fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. And I hear the voice of many angels sing, worthy is the Lamb. And I
now we pray that the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And that the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit will be among us and remain with us always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.